Good morning, Mike, and good morning to your televiewers.
All right, so Sir Jerry, let me just get your thoughts first about this recent announcement by Energy Undersecretary Sharon Garin that the DOE is including nuclear power in the energy plan starting in 2032 with a target of 2,500 megawatts. So in terms of the scope, the energy consumption, give us a sense of how big a target this is. But the bigger question is, are we ready for it?
First of all, the target is actually really small, right? It's a starting point, but it's a starting point to I don't know the term, but it's very horrific that that the Department of Energy is pursuing setting up or deploying nuclear in a very problematic country in terms of the implication of security of deploying nuclear power plants. We know for a fact that we're in the Ring of Fire, and most countries within the Ring of Fire, which has a lot of volcanic activities, have experienced our neighboring country like Japan, right? They're even transitioning away from nuclear. So it's just mind-boggling that the Department of Energy is still pursuing this. One of the key reasons as we're raising this is that we have a vast potential of renewable energy, which is basically more than 10 times of the current capacity, meaning we haven't really scratched the surface of the renewable energy potential. All we need to do is lay down the foundation, which we have done in the past 3 years. And it's more of the political will right now to actually indigenous safe and affordable and sustainable sources of electricity.
In your conversations with the DOE, if you have, wasn't it factored in that the Philippines is in the Ring of Fire? We have frequent volcanic activity and even earthquakes. What did they say about that?
The justification right now is that technologies have matured, and that new technologies as the smaller ones that are easily deployable and easily and are more are safer from what they've said is the main reason. But if we ask the like for example, who is there a politician that would allow a modular type of nuclear in their own backyard? I don't think any politician or any resident would allow that. Notwithstanding, our main question, the other one aside from the diverting away from renewable energy potential, is that have we factored in? Because one of the key arguments is that aside from security, is that renewable energy is far more cheaper because it generates a lot of electricity compared to the equivalent resources that you need to use. The key question there is, have we factored in the waste disposal in terms of prices? We haven't heard an answer on that in our engagement with the Department of Energy and all the consultation, even in the House or the Senate. Because if you factor that in, it's in perpetuity that you need to manage it. It's there for the not just for the rest of our lives, but actually for generations to come. And who will shoulder the burden of securing that? And it's in perpetuity. So I guess the government will have to bear the consequences in terms of the prices of waste disposal and management. We cannot even manage our own waste current waste disposal. The whole implementation of our law on organic or on waste segregation is not fully implemented. How can we actually manage a radioactive waste?
So you're saying that it's not actually cheap. if we resort to nuclear energy. What about even generating nuclear energy? You need uranium for that. Do we have the sources for that?
Definitely, we will be the country if it will be embarking into, you know, developing the nuclear capacity, will be importing more. Mm-hmm. And that will exacerbate our vulnerability and energy security coming being too overly dependent. We're now very import dependent power sector. We import 75% of our coal that is being burned by our coal plants, which produces around more or less 60% of electricity. Notwithstanding now that Malampaya is depleting and now we are entering into dependency again in our gas sector. And this will only add up to over-dependence. And that's why we've been arguing and we've been engaging the government that, you know, we do not need to be exacerbating that dependency because it's mainly energy insecurity. Mm-hmm. We will be very susceptible to international and volatile price shocks. And that's why we've been urging the government to just, you know, have the resoluteness to tap our own domestic resources, which is far more vast. And it's not just one resource, not just solar, not just wind, but hydro, geothermal, tidal, and so many others in terms of renewable energy potential.
Let me just touch on that safety issue in a bit, because the Undersecretary for the DOE, Yusek Garin, has said that among the options that they're looking at is the resort to the mothballed Bataan nuclear power plant, but that has been declared unsafe. So she's saying that it's up to the investors, really, which mode to resort to. Right? It could be the modular, the smaller ones, or even the power plant. So given what happened to Fukushima, to Chernobyl, and even concerns around several nuclear power plants being attacked in Ukraine, are the fears surrounding the safety of resorting to nuclear energy actually justified?
I don't think it has been, you know, it has been addressed squarely and scientifically, and because of the vulnerability of the country, it's just really mind-boggling that the national government is still pursuing this. We can only you know, look at how regulatory capture is mm-hmm. unfolding, and the lobby of businesses, because there are so many studies already that have been lodged, protests coming from local communities, especially in Bataan, in terms of the whole consultation process, and I don't think it has been squarely heard of and incorporated in their deliberation of finalizing and pursuing this track.
Jerry, has there been a feasibility study on this? Like, how feasible is it that in a span of 9 years we will be ready to come up with nuclear energy in the energy mix? I understand that there are certain infrastructural requirements imposed by the IAEA. Can we meet them in 9 years' time?
We've been telling the government that, you know, it will be beyond this government lifespan. And especially even the regulatory mechanisms, right? We're just mm-hmm. in that phase. It hasn't been finished yet. Mm-hmm. The lower house has passed its bill. It will go through the Senate for higher scrutiny and debates. And I hope that the Senate will open up public debates on it. And it will be a long run, and notwithstanding the whole infrastructure which is required, I don't think 9 years would really be feasible mm-hmm. from the studies and from the experiences and practices that we've seen.
Are we at the point, though, where we are in desperate need to find alternative energy sources? We have, of course, the NGCP last week warning there might be power interruptions this summer because of the Energy Regulatory Commission's objections to extending the ancillary services agreements that the NGCP has with certain suppliers while it is undergoing a competitive selection process. Is it really a problem of the lack of sources of energy, or is this a problem of mismanagement?
It's actually both, and there are so many challenges that have already been discussed in the last 3 years alone, and resolutions were already forwarded, and I can definitely say that you know what's happening in NGCP in terms of you know the ancillary services. The committed from non-committed to committed because it is important to stabilize the power grid, especially during the times of peak season. That has been, you know, it is already a known fact that it's that NGCP just need to follow the rules and to follow the law. It's not the fault of ERC. It's really funny that the NGCP would blame the ERC because they were the ones who were remiss. It's already in the law that you know a player in the power sector needs to go through a competitive selection process and remiss on that, and that's why they've been penalized last year. So the players need to act and do their share. And if the problem continues, I think you know the Senate and the House needs to have a conversation in terms of assessing the whole privatization process, because you know it seems that the other sectors in the power the whole power sector is not you know it's not compliant to the whole set of rules. But in terms of sources, there's really a need for us to, because the economy is growing, right? So as the economy grows, you need more power to fuel, quote unquote, the growth. So you really need to have more power plants. At the same time, notwithstanding that most of our power plants are already old power plants, like 40 years, 30 years. So the efficiency is really lower. So you need to replace it. And most of these are coal plants. And you know, coal plants are very expensive nowadays. So you really need to have a pathway to generate more electricity, especially as we phase out these coal plants. And that's why the country needs to really focus on tapping its renewable energy resources. We have different and various mechanisms that were recently promulgated to actually pursue this track. So like, for example, very concrete, all the local government units now can actually build their own 1 megawatt, multiple 1 megawatt power plants, renewable energy power plants, so that you know it can produce electricity in their constituency because it's for their own use. So imagine all the LDUs deploying at least, at the very least, 1 megawatt of renewable energy sources.
What's preventing us from doing that, though? What about the administrative or the administration of those local power generating sources?
There's plenty of business models to actually be pursuing that, either through a joint venture with private entities. There are various models that can be pursued, actually, Mike. And notwithstanding the capacity of local electric cooperatives, so you just need to tie it up. But definitely, Mike, you're spot on that, and that's why the national government needs to also look at you know assisting technically this energy transition. But there are many business models that can, in the interim, can actually address that, like leasing models, that private entities can manage it, and local government gets the lowest cost. Renewable energy, for example, solar PV system that are ground mounted, can actually go as low as 3 pesos to 5 pesos. So imagine the gas and coal based electricity nowadays, which ranges from 9 pesos to hilariously at around 16 to 17 pesos. So it's really competitive. And you know, in terms of the, it's easily deployable. It doesn't take 2 years to actually set it up. At the very least, 3 to 6 months. That's the average of setting up a 1 megawatt plant. Of course, depending on the availability of land or a series of rooftops by LGUs.
Mm-hmm. Jerry, I do want to get your thoughts, though, on the recent development that Meralco has signed an emergency supply agreement with San Miguel for 300 megawatt of baseload capacity. And of course, this is a consequence of the Court of Appeals actually stopping that power supply agreement. What do you make of this, though, that we have this development, we have a power supply agreement, the court stopped it, now we have to resort to an emergency supply agreement. Is this an indication of the way we're managing the power or the energy sector?
It's just that one is really mind-boggling, Mike. You know, an entity just walked away from a contract that they were the ones who actually pursued it, and even bragged in 2020 to electric consumers that you don't need to panic in terms of you know, high cost of electricity, because our contract is straight pricing and the rest is history. And now Meralco is entering in another contract with the same entity,
not subject to bidding.
Yes, there's 2 points on this. It's not subject to bidding because it's an emergency PSA. So, and that's why we're really urging the national government to look into the possibility of putting in place a tweak competitive selection process rules on emergency power supply agreements, because it's highway robbery. It really highway robbery, because it's one of the key reasons why we're having high prices of electricity and why we're one of the highest in Asia, and that's why we were really welcoming the full implementation of the competitive selection process 2 years ago. And now we have all these emergency power supply agreements, which circumvents that. The second point is that they got away with, you know, what they really want to pass on fuel costs. So even though the argument is that the price of this EPSA, emergency power supply agreement, is lower, We've already said this in our petitions and many others. There's a difference between a two-part tariff structure of power supply agreements, because there's hidden costs. While at the surface it's cheaper, at the end of the day, when your bill comes in, it's higher, because it has a pass-on fuel cost component, like straight pricing. So this EPSA is a two-part tariff system PSA. So one can expect higher costs of electricity due to this EPSA. And that's why this is really hilarious that Meralco is pursuing this agreement with the same entity that, you know, that put us in this situation. And so the national government and policymakers need to address this. There has to be changes in rules. Entities such as this company should be having new rules that bars entities that walks away from contracts and puts the power system in peril, and then comes in again with a kill in terms of prices of electricity.
And we are, of course, open to hearing the side of San Miguel on this issue. And Jerry, lastly, on another topic, let me get your thoughts too on the Mindanao oil spill. What's your assessment of how the government is actually dealing with the issue or handling the incident? This is not the first time, so it's not an isolated incident. What do you think is the root cause of these incidents, and what can be done to prevent them from happening all over again?
First of all, in terms of the assessment, there are various key elements to this. One, it's really frustrating that it's been more than a month and we are not able to deploy an ROV that is capable of sealing because the tanker is still spilling oil continuously, and so one can ask, you know, have we learned our lessons from the Guimaras oil spill, right? So that's really mind-boggling, and so that in itself should actually be addressed concretely, and at the same time, several policies needs to actually be in place, and one of that key policy should actually consider concretely the Verde Island Passage to be, you know, a no-go zone. Mm-hmm. Because it's not just a treasure for Batangas and Mindoro. It's a treasure, not just even a treasure for the Philippines. It's a global treasure because mm-hmm. it's the center of global marine shorefish. And we need to really take care of that. And a very concrete step would be to include it in the INAIPAS, the expanded protected system, because it's not yet included in the protected system as a very valuable seascape. The last point I want to make here is that it seems the national government is trying to downplay the implication of the oil spill. And that's why we're urging for a proper evaluation of the implication, because billions and billions from marine resources are in peril, notwithstanding the tourism industry in Toro. Alone, this summer will be the peak season for Puerto Galera and the rest of the tourist industry in Mindoro. It will affect San Juan and Lobo, which are, you know, resort areas. And I think we the national government really have to be true and transparent in terms of their evaluation of the implication. And you know, proper response should actually be pursued. Mm-hmm. We're actually contemplating that we might need to actually pursue declaring a national state of calamity because of the implication. And this is not just for months, Mike. Mm-hmm. As we reflected on the Guimaras disaster, it took them 13 years to rehabilitate the impacted area. So what does that mean to 2 million of fisherfolk communities in the whole of Verde Island Passage? Mindoro alone, it's oriental, it's 18,000 mm-hmm. families of fisherfolk communities. So the implication is just, you know, really, really heavy, and mm-hmm. the response is not adequate.
Mm-hmm. Well, you have authorities saying 170,000 people affected. On that note, Jerry Aranzes, Executive Director for the Center for Energy, Ecology, and Development. Thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you, Mike, and good morning to all the televiewers.